So the first message that the Fibonacci numbers had to teach for us is that so spotting the self-similarity, so that can be mathematically beautiful, but then might lead to an inefficient solution. So we also realize that some things can have a different self-similarities, and then some of those work better than the others. There we're gonna see the example of the binary exponentiation for that situation. But so the idea here of a recursive definition, so if we think of like a fantasy terms, like this is like a hobbit village, like every multiplication is like a little hobbit, and then the hobbits are here, they're playing tug of war with the friendly giant of some kind. So the factorial function is a thing, but it's like a big thing. So one factorial giant, so it's equivalent to an entire row of little hobbits pulling the tug of war at the other side. So this is the game of tug of war, so equality says that these two are perfectly balanced. So however complicated thing this is, so because this is an equal thing, so is equally complicated. But then the little brother of the friendly giant comes in and joins the line, so takes place of n minus one hobbits here. So notice a big giant is equal to a slightly smaller giant, and then just one little hobbit instead of an entire row of them. So this principle that the self-similarity, especially for complicated functions, because so fn on the left-hand side of the definition is complicated, and then you wanna build up the right-hand side definition of the things that you know how to do, so you don't want those to be too complicated. So now, if you manage to bring the kid brother of the friendly giant in here, so the harder that the giant is pulling the tug of war on the left-hand side of the equation, then the harder the kid brother is gonna be pulling for you. So hopefully then what other extra hobbit you need to add in there is gonna be simple enough for you. So it's like this kind of a bootstrapping in the difficulty, that the more powerful function, the more it helps in solving itself. Okay, so that's the way to look at it. But let's look at the branching recursion. So all the interesting recursions are branching. So any linear recursion, we always write as a loop, more efficient and better in any way. Now in principle, so from the computational standpoint, so the theme that I emphasized from day one is that we need a very few primitive operations, two-way decision, repetition, to express any computation. So hopefully it doesn't come as a too big of a surprise. So taking the result from a later theory of computability courses, that the recursion and iteration, so whatever you can express with one, you can always somehow express with the other one. But depending on the situation, so self-similar branching problems, the tool that we reach is a recursion. Good to have both in your toolkit. Some problems are easier to understand recursively. And then once we have that linear recursion, so then we just mechanically translate into a loop. So no linear recursions, just branching recursions, exponential branching. Now then the recursion for safety and reasons has a limit if the recursion level becomes deep enough, so Python keeps track of that. Then the recursion is forcefully terminated, so there is a place you can increment the limit, but in principle you never need to, because we don't write linear recursions. We only write the branching recursions and any exponential branching. So if 1000 levels is not enough for you, because then there's already gonna be way more leaves than there is atoms in the universe. So then you're doing something wrong to begin with.